Thank you very much for the kind invitation to talk. I very much enjoy my stay here. Before starting with the topic, I would like to mention my co-workers. I will not write them down, but just mention the name. So this is Zizek Burda from Krakow, who introduced me to the topic about 2 years ago. Then there's Taro Nago, Eugene Strahov, Lu Wei, who was a student in telecommunications in Helsinki, and last but not least, two people from my group, Jesper Itzen, who is doing his PhD, and Mario Kiburg, who is currently my postdoc, is a very talented young man. And all these works you can find on the archive from 2012 onwards. Okay, so what is the object of my study? Maybe let me start here. So what we want to look at are products of matrices Xn. So the X's shall be independent n times n matrices, and they shall have a Gaussian distribution. When I write down, I have to introduce a probability space. For every matrix, I would integrate over all independent matrix elements. I will say in a moment what these are, and then give all of them a Gaussian measure, where this is the Hermitian conjugate. And the matrix elements for every matrix KL, they will be in general complex. I will also say a little bit about the quaternionic version, and I will say next to nothing about real matrix elements. There's only something known for two products of two matrices, and these are of course labeled by what we call the Dyson index. So the number of independent matrix elements per XKL. Now, what I would like to study is matrices which have the least symmetry. So I will study matrices Xj that are complex non-Hermitian. Now, why is that? Well, the reason is very simple. If you would start out with a matrix that has a certain symmetry, so it's real symmetric, and you start multiplying real symmetric matrices, the product will not be real symmetric. So for simplicity, I will start out with matrices that have the least symmetry already to begin with. Okay? I'm sorry? This. Times? Which coefficient? That's a trace, sorry. So I take the trace of x, x, dagger, and I don't sum over j, okay? So that's for every j. So I have n of these, okay? So clearly the matrices are non-Hermitian. And for if I would just take a single matrix rather than taking a whole product, this would have a name, and this name is attached to Jean Ginibre, who wrote down all these three ensembles of random matrices just with a single matrix in 1967, I believe, or 65. Okay, now, so before I start massaging these matrices, I would like to give a little bit of motivation. So maybe for still something. I'm sorry. Yes. Sorry. Okay. So everything is clear now, the starting point, I hope. Good. So now I hope I do not have to motivate why people study single random matrices. I mean, there are many applications. The reason why you would study a product, well, that actually goes back to work by Fürstenberg and Kesten, which was done here in Princeton in 1960. There they would look at what is called Lyapunov exponents, and they would look at, they would think of studying time evolution cut into finite steps, and every step would be represented by a matrix. You can also think of something like that to model transfer matrices. There are other applications. One of them is something I have worked on, which is a quantum chromodynamics. However, there you only need two matrices, and I may come back to that later. Further applications would be scattering in quantum systems. So people study like quantum dots, and then so they have leads attached to a dot, and then some particles go in, scatter, come out again, or continue. And if you would put several quantum dots, you would have kind of product of the scattering matrices. Or another motivation comes from telecommunications, where people study, rather than looking at transmitting signals from a single antenna to another antenna, they study transmission from an array of antennas to another array to improve the signal. And the person who is an expert on that is Sergio Verdu, who is here at Princeton in the engineering department. So he can explain much more about this application. Okay, now in my title, I put finite and infinite size. So you may ask why n and little n finite. I should say I cannot review all the whole literature, but Fürstenberg and Kesten, for example, they studied the limit when the number of matrices you multiply goes to infinity. Now, what I will do today mainly, although I will also come to the limit n goes to infinity, is to study both the size of the matrix and the number of products to be finite. And the reason is that, if we want to study universality, it's better to have a starting point where everything is fixed at finite matrix size and finite number, because then you have a full control how to take various limits. Now, the limit I will take this talk is n goes to infinity at the end, and I will keep n fixed. And of course, another reason to treat the system is, you can write it down and solve it. That's always a good point. And I should emphasize that, at least to my knowledge, writing down product of matrices and then doing derivations for finite n and a finite number of product was not known before, although there's a huge literature on the limit of the number of products going to an infinity, of course, with the exception of 2x2 matrices. There, of course, you can do everything explicitly, and that was indeed done. Okay, one more word before I start with some results. What I'm restricting myself here to is the simplest case. So just Gaussian non-Hermitian random matrices. We and other people have looked at other cases, so other choices. So another choice would be to choose the XJs rectangular. Of course, you have to be careful such that the matrix product still makes sense. So you would have a matrix nj times nj plus nu j. Now, if you do that, what happens is that this Gaussian here gets multiplied by a determinant to the power nu j, and otherwise things don't change. So for simplicity, I will not consider these factors. This will just make more indices appear and make life a little bit harder, but I mean, the principle goes through. Another case that has been considered is truncated unitary matrices. So suppose you start with a matrix of size n plus l, and then you start erasing l rows and columns. You get a matrix that's subunitary. And then even if the starting matrices are distributed, if you multiply these truncated ones, you cannot absorb matrices into each other, into the measure. So this is a non-trivial result. Another thing you can do is you could start to study inverse Genevre matrices. This was done by a group around Krishnapur in Bangalore. And last but not least, you could also think of mixing these kind of matrices. That's something you can do, but I will not talk about it. Peculiarity is that when you mix factors from different of these ensembles, the order will actually not matter. This was shown by Jesper Ibsen and Mari Kiburg from my group. So I will stick to this choice. Now, the last thing I have to tell you is what are we actually going to look at? And there you have two choices. If you look at such a product matrix Pn, you can either look at the eigenvalues. Those will be complex. Or you can look at what is called the singular values. Now, maybe let me remind you of a little bit of linear algebra, just in case. So suppose you would have a Hermitian matrix. You all know that you could diagonalize this matrix with a unitary matrix, and the eigenvalues would sit here in a diagonal matrix. Now, if you have a non-Hermitian matrix, you can still write it in this way, where this T now is an upper triangular matrix or lower. You may choose that. And this is called Schur decomposition. Whereas for the singular values, now let's take Pn, you would need two unitary matrices. So U and V are in Un. Now S is a diagonal matrix, and the elements of S, so S1, Sn, these are positive real numbers, and that's because the singular values are just related to the eigenvalues of the matrix PP dagger, which is positive definite. And so if you square the singular values, you get the eigenvalues of this. Okay. Now, if we want to treat now our product, you see that this is not a good idea, because we would have to put here indices J. Now, so what we did is we did a generalized Schur decomposition such that when you multiply all these, the unitary matrices here will sandwich. You can do that. Well, I will probably not have time to explain. You may ask later. Now, note that if we do such a generalized Schur decomposition, that these lambdas are no longer the eigenvalues of xj. Okay? But what holds is that the eigenvalues of the product matrix P, so the eigenvalues of Pn, let's label them Za. So they will be just the product of lambda 1a, lambda 2a, lambda na. Okay? So they will be the product of the lambda. So this capital lambda is a diagonal matrix, has every one has entries lambda 1 to lambda n. Okay, is that clear? So once we do that, we can now either look at correlation functions of complex. Yes, please? Okay. So, okay, let me. It's up here. So lambda j is okay. Now, if you multiply Pn x1, x2, xn, you can write this as U1 lambda 1 plus T1 U2 dagger U2 lambda 2 plus T2, etc. Of course, when I write that, I mean that U sub n plus 1 is again U1. Okay? And then the eigenvalues, well, this all multiplies out. And the eigenvalues sit in the product of the capital lambdas. And that's the relation I was trying to write down here. You want to know how to prove this?
No. How do you know that when you have a sequence of matrices, you can always find this?
Yes, this is what goes under the name of generalized Schur decomposition. So what, in order to prove that, you would first do a Schur decomposition of, okay, let me write that here. So you would do a Schur decomposition of x1, x2, xn as u1, let's call that s, so that's an upper, well, that's a bad name. Let's call it r, u1 dagger. So this is now a triangular matrix, and you bring the u's to the other side. And then you do a QR decomposition of the last factor here, u times u1. And then you do that iteratively, so then you fill in all the u's. And that's how you prove that you can find such a parametrization. Well, please note, I mean, these are not the eigenvalues of x.
I mean the r.
Yes, but I mean, you were asking how to, why there's a generalized Schur decomposition.
No, so, I'm asking,
yes? Yes. Yes, but of course, what I have to do, and this is what I will write down next, I will start from this here. So let me write this down. So and now I do this generalized Schur decomposition here, and I want to arrive at the distribution of complex eigenvalue of the product matrix. They are, of course, as you say, they are in here. But I only have the distribution for the individual x's. So for every x, I can do this, then compute the Jacobian, and compute the weight function. Now, what comes out of this? So that's the first result. So now we are talking about eigenvalues. Please keep in mind that we always have to make a choice, rather looking at eigenvalues or at singular values. So it may be a bit confusing. It's the same matrix model. But if you ask different questions, you get different answers. And funnily enough, in the random matrix model literature, this also has different names. One name I forgot to mention here. So if you just have n equals 1 and you look at the singular values, this ensemble is called the Wishart ensemble. Or it also goes under the name of Laguerre ensemble. And it has a third name that's called chiral unitary ensemble. They're all the same. And then, well, limiting distribution, you may know, is a Marchenko-Pastour for rectangular matrices, etc. But it's the same matrix model. I mean, just such is life. OK, so first result for complex, so eigenvalues is EV. The result I'm writing down now is the joint intensity or joint probability distribution for the complex eigenvalues. So this is now, of course, you will get the product of u's. And then you get a product of complex eigenvalues. You get a weight function, and you get a Vandermonde determinant, so delta n of z. This is just the product over a larger than b z minus z, or okay. So this is the Vandermonde determinant. So this is the first result. And if you like, I can call this here the joint probability distribution function. So let me, OK, I may have skipped here some constants. What is which vector? This is the weight function. This is what I still have to write down. So in fact, the weight function only depends on the modulus, which is nice, and it's given by up to some factors of pi by the following object. And this is called Meyer G function. Now, the first remark here is that this is a determinantal point process, because we have here a determinant times a determinant complex conjugate. Yes, please. I'm sorry. Yes, or I should put here an integral. Thank you. Other questions? Yes, of course. So maybe let me give an example. Okay, so example. It's just the exponential function. So we are back to Ginibre. Okay, so this is the result of Jean Ginibre from 1965, I believe. You have an exponential function. Well, it's not surprising, because when you start with a Gaussian weight, you diagonalize, you compute the Jacobian, and that is what you get. Now, let me give you a second example. That's a Bessel function or MacDonald function. I think maybe up to some factor of pi or so, which is not important. Now, what is the general expression for this Meyer G function? Now, maybe before we do that, I would like to point you to the general structure. So the general idea how you would go and solve this random matrix model, you see it's determinantal. The weight function, no matter what this beast is, only depends on the modulus. Now, you would seek orthogonal polynomials with respect to that weight function. So you would look for, and the polynomials orthogonal with respect to something rotation invariant are just the monic powers, just because of the angular integration that kills everything. So Z, J, Z, K. Okay. So the only thing that is non-trivial here, so this is a complex conjugate, are to compute the norms of these polynomials. Once you have them, you can write down the kernel, and then due to Dyson's theorem, you can compute all correlation functions. So all we have to do, basically, is to compute moments of the weight function. So this is what I will do now. So let me first tell you what the G function is. In general, this is a special function with four sets.
So this, if you have a weight function,
yes.
then what's the next point? This is the terminal point process, but then what have you written here? The integral of
The integral of this is delta k. So these are the orthogonal polynomials that we seek. So the polynomials are completely trivial.
Oh, they're trivial, yeah.
The only thing that's not trivial is the normalization, because the kernel. Okay, let me write this down. So then we have the kernel KNZ. It's just a prefactor. Okay, here comes the normalization, because the kernel has to have also normal polynomials, otherwise it's not a kernel. And then from this follows that all correlation functions, because it's determinantal, are given by the determinant of this kernel. So the only thing that in this case I have to compute are the norms that will come here. And I can already tell you what they are. I think it's just n. So for n equals 1, these are just exponentials cut off. That's for Ginibre. For the general case, this is the result. And then we know all correlation functions. Now, I should have also told you even though you may get a different impression. The case of complex eigenvalues is the simpler case. That's why I'm telling it here. What I will tell about the singular values will be slightly more complicated, and that's why I choose to mainly focus on the complex eigenvalues. Okay, so the question still is, what is this Meyer G function beast? Now, in general, it's a special function. You see already it's not so special in some special cases. It depends on four sets of indices, and it's given by some contour integral over the gamma function. So maybe that's not even worth writing it down. I've told it to you. But I will write down another expression that is much more useful when computing the moments. And that's the one that we got when we computed the JPDF. And that is, in fact, given by the following integral. Okay, these errors are maybe a bit irritating. So it's just a product of integrals, Gaussian integrals, of the axis. Well, the axis I should have maybe called lambda, because that makes life clearer for you. Well, never mind. I mean, this is just a definition of, this is what we get for the Meyer G function. And this you can somehow believe that would come up from this computation, from this line to the bottom line. Okay. Now, of course, we didn't know that the Meyer G function comes out. We just knew this is our weight function. Then we wrote on a recursion. We did a Mellin transform. Then the recursion becomes the product. You invert the Mellin transform, and then you get exactly this integral over gamma functions. That's how you do it. Now, why do I write down this multiple integral form here? Well, because from that, it immediately follows that the moments of this beast are trivial. Well, what are the moments? They are just given by z2k of this. Okay. Now you see, just plug that in, the additional integral is killed by the delta function. And then this whole thing just factorizes dx e to the minus x to the power n. And that's just pi. Sorry, there's a k here. K factorial. Okay. And that is true for also more general G functions. So this is how you see why we get this kernel. And now the last thing we have to do is just to compute all correlation functions. They are defined as follows. Zk. So they're basically taking this joint intensity and integrating out n minus k eigenvalues. So for example, if you integrate out n minus 1, you just keep 1, you get a density. Okay, so this is just dzk plus 1. Zn. So this is up to a constant definition. And by Dyson's theorem, or in other words, saying this is a determinantal point process, we just get that this is the determinant of Kn Z I Z j, where the determinant runs from 1. Okay. So, in that sense, we have solved the problem. Now, maybe there's time for two asides. The first question is now, should we be surprised to get Meyer G functions appearing here? And the answer is no, we shouldn't. Because there's a theorem by Springer and Thompson from 1970. But they studied random variables instead of random matrices. So And what they stated is that if you take xk being gamma distributed, okay, I have many, maybe too many x's here. Let me call them y. Okay, and you take the product of these random variables that are gamma distributed, then the product has as a probability distribution a Meyer G function. Okay, and then you have here more indices, minus 1, bn minus 1. And you have here, okay, z. And of course, this almost looks like the distribution we have here. It's just that the y's here are the modulo square, and our b's here are 1, so that this factor is gone. So if you would take simple gamma distributions, you would just get the Meyer G function. Of course, I didn't know that when we wrote the first paper. We just showed that this comes out. And only later, when I started working with a mathematician, Eugene Strahov, he figured out that, well, for random variables, this is known. So in a way, the random matrices behave a bit like the random variables, as you might expect. Okay. Maybe I can make a second aside. So this is why this is known, or this could be expected. Now, as I said, I could also give you some motivation why this appears in QCD. And so let me do that now. The reason is that what I've told you so far here, that was all true for beta equals 2, so for complex matrices, and all xj are independent. Now you would, of course, ask, well, what about taking products of real matrices or of maybe quaternion, although they are maybe not so popular? Well, quaternions can be done. I'll come back to that. But for real matrices, this is an open problem. So as a parenthesis, let me tell you what can be done about real matrices. And that brings me to another part of the motivation. So that is, so let's look back at n equals 2, where much more is known, actually. So now suppose you look at something called the Dirac operator in quantum field theory. If you write that down in a chiral basis, what you find is that this operator has the following form. So it's anti-Hermitian. Now the eigenvalues are clearly the eigenvalues of the product of these two matrices. So this would be singular values. They are purely imaginary, but that's as good as having real eigenvalues. Now, what happens if you add a chemical potential to that? Well, then you can add here a second matrix. I'll call this x2 and this here x1. So the eigenvalues. Can you still read that? So the eigenvalues of D amounts to compute the eigenvalues of x1 times x2. So that's n equals 2. That's another motivation from QCD plus chemical potential. And that in this form, this was proposed. Yes, please. OK, I'm just talking now about the structure here. OK, now. Well, if I write the structure, I'm not dropping anything. I'm just maybe put things on a lattice to have a regularization. Now, the step that matches this to a random matrix problem, where now I look at the eigenvalues of the product of two random matrices, this was proposed by Jacques Verbascot. So that's, of course, a big simplification that I'm not going to explain here. That will be another talk, please.
So can I understand by you has the interpretation of a chemical potential?
Yes. Well, it's maybe what you would write down is something like this in the first place. So you add mu times psi dagger psi, or if you write it in psi bar psi, mu times gamma naught times pi by psi. Now, gamma naught has this form, so that's where you would add the mu in the chiral basis. Now, the step that I do here to have a second matrix is to say, okay, we are looking here at a basis where the chemical potential term is not diagonal, and that's why I put a second matrix here.
This comes in for the property. The inverse of this is supposed to be the property.
Yes. Right? Yes. 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 So if you would have a...
That's why I'm missing the usual...
Well, what you are missing is the map QCD to random matrix theory, okay? And that's something I will not explain here. I just wanted to give this as a motivation that if you buy this map, and I can explain that in private why it is a good idea, it's of course a simplification, a huge simplification of the quantum field theory, that then you end up at a problem where you calculate the eigenvalues of the product of two random matrices. That's all I want to say here, okay?
Well, when you trace out the fermions, you get a determinant.
Yes, yes, exactly. And that would lead to a measure that would look like this here. And that's why I call this mu, because it's, okay. Maybe I should not have given this motivation, because it confuses people. The reason I'm mentioning that is that this is an example where we can compute everything, the spectral correlations like here, in the case where the two matrices X1 and X2 are not independent. Well, why is that? You can see that because if you take now mu equal to 0, so this is gone, then clearly X1 is equal to minus X2 dagger, okay? Now, if you put mu equals to 1, you can see that they are clearly independent.
And psi.
Yes. Yes. I have to say that the psi here has a Gaussian distribution. Now you solve this for x1 and x2. You plug it into the Gaussian. And then you see that for general mu, you have a coupling term that couples x1 and x2. So they're not independent. And only for mu equals 1, they are again independent. So that's a special case where we can do this. And we can actually do that for all beta. Beta equals 2, 4, and 1. Sorry for squeezing it into this corner here. And that was actually done previously to the story that I was telling you about the Meyer G function. We didn't know about Meyer G functions. We only knew, okay, we get this funny result here that rather than taking two Gaussians, looking at the product of two Gaussian variables, you get a K-Bessel function. And the solution here is then done in a similar fashion as here. The only difference is that now nothing is rotational invariant anymore, because of the coupling. So you need to work harder. You don't have this relation here that you have just monic polynomials. It turns out you get Laguerre polynomials that are orthogonal in the complex plane with respect to this K-Bessel weight function here. Okay, so that's something you have to do. But if you do it, you can show all that. Okay. Well,
for ZI near ZJ, do I see bigger Dyson type statistics?
Well, I will come to that. When you talk about universality, you have to take the larger limit, because at finite n, also Gaussian. So this is something that I still have to do. Maybe one thing before doing the larger limit is I can briefly tell you what the situation is for singular values, okay? I have a little bit of space left. So maybe you remember. Okay, that's good. So now, rather than taking this Schur decomposition, going to a complex eigenvalues, we now do a singular value decomposition. Actually, the way we do that is we change first variables and do the following. So we define some new matrices. Now, if you insert this here, you see that you will get some x, some yj's and yj inverses. No, you get a whole bunch of them.
Yeah,
x is the y term. Yes, and j goes, okay. So x1 is y1, y2 is x1, x2, et cetera.
Yeah.
When you do that and you put that in, you get a whole bunch of Itzigsen-Zuber or Harishchandra integrals. You can do all them. But you see that life gets much more complicated. Do not just get a single Vandermonde determinant here. In fact, you have to work a little bit to get rid of most of these determinants. And what comes out at the end of the day is the following result. Now this is for singular values. Well, you still get some constants, okay, some du's. Let me be here very sloppy. And then what you get is you get a product 1 to n dsj. Oh, let me, okay. And you get a Vandermonde determinant of these singular values times a determinant, which again has this Meyer G function. So let me write this down. Okay, this is the determinant over some indices, let's say A and B. So you have here B minus 1 as A. Okay. Now, clearly, this is much more complicated. This is now what is called a bi-orthogonal ensemble in the sense of Borodin. So you can still solve that if you are able to compute now a set of functions that is orthogonal and write down a kernel that solves for all correlation functions. Okay? Okay, bi-orthogonal means that, I mean, here we had a set of polynomials, P and P complex conjugate, that are orthogonal. Now what we will get, well, I can just write it down. We get a set of functions. One of them is actually polynomial, and the other one is not. So what you are looking for is the following relation here. I have to tell you what P and chi are. So let me see if I have that here. Yes, I mean, it's basically like a Laguerre polynomial, except one difference. Now, if you would have a 2 here, this would be a Laguerre polynomial. Now, I said that in the example for the Meyer G function here, we get an exponential. Now, because of this thing here, for n equals 1, this is x to the, sorry, sa b minus 1 e to the minus sa. Okay. Then you could take out this. You would get a Laguerre weight, and you get 2 Vandermonde determinants. That's the case of the Wishart-Laguerre ensemble. Okay. And in that case, we know that the polynomials that are orthogonal with respect to Laguerre are Laguerre polynomials. Okay. Now here, life is a bit more complicated. Now if you remember how to solve things with orthogonal polynomials, in principle what you do is you use that, well, this is the determinant of 1's, z1, zn, z1, n minus 1. Now determinants you can change by adding columns. So if you find a clever way to find polynomials that are orthogonal with respect to that weight, you are done. The problem here is that these are not polynomials, so you have to find linear combinations of the G's such that you get some polynomials times this that are orthogonal to each other. So maybe let me write down the result, and then you see maybe what I mean. So this would be like or I can also write it as a linear combination of my G functions with some coefficients. Okay, and it's just a matter of using integrals to show that this and this polynomial satisfy this orthogonality. And from this, you get a new kernel, Kn, that is sum over L 0 to n minus 1, PL of S times chi L of T, divided by the norm, which I don't compute for you. And all correlation functions of singular values are now expressed in terms of the kernel of these orthogonal functions. Okay? It's called bi-orthogonal because these two are no longer the same polynomials. Okay? That's why it's called bi-orthogonal.
Are they orthogonal with respect to different ways? Each other with respect to different weights?
No, they are, well, they are orthogonal with respect to the weight 1, because if you like, the weight is inside this chi function here, if you look at this relation here. Okay? You don't seem to be happy.
No. No, I don't understand. Sorry.
So the trick to solve this model here, it's still determinantal. I didn't say that, but it's a determinantal point process. Is to do the following. You take the first Vandermonde. Now you combine the polynomials in a clever way, namely in this way. Okay. Now you take the g functions here. You take linear combinations. I mean, it's a determinant of, so you can add rows. So you take a linear combination of the g function in the fashion I wrote down here. Now you get here a determinant of the p's and here a determinant of the chi's. And because they are orthogonal, you have solved the problem. Okay, I would need another, invoke another theorem that shows it. But I mean, it's really like these Wigner-Dyson ensembles. The only difference is that you now have, instead of one set of polynomials, you have a set of polynomials and a set of functions.
So at the end, when you have a form of polynomials.
Yes. Well, that is the part about universality, and that I should probably explain now. So at the moment, we just have a class of random matrix models. We have products of them. We can solve them for finite n, either for the complex eigenvalues or for the singular values. And please note that these chi's, they are not polynomials. I mean, okay. Maybe if I remind you that, when I take n equal to 1, then this will be Laguerre polynomial. This will be Laguerre polynomial times e to the minus s. So that's how you should think about it. Okay, just now this is more general, a general set of functions. Okay, now large n limit. So the question is, have we computed something new here in the large n limit, or do we get what is known already for taking a single random matrix rather than a product? And the answer is both. I mean, in some limit we get something new, and in another limit we don't. So let me. So large n. Okay, because we were just talking about singular values, maybe I first talk about singular values, not to confuse ourselves. So, singular values. Now, what was known, and that was known previous to our work, was how the limiting density behaves. Now, the limiting density is defined as follows. We are talking singular values now. So this is just the kernel at equal arguments. Okay. Now, it was known in works by my collaborator Borda and his company that this can be extracted in a somewhat complicated way. I mean, you know, for just a single matrix, the way you compute things is you do not directly look at the density, you look at the resolvent. Row of t z minus t t. And then the resolvent satisfies a quadratic equation. And the solution then gives you Marchenko-Pastour. Now, here for more than one matrix, the equation for the resolvent is actually a polynomial equation. It looks like this. So this was in a work by Borda et al. So for, okay, for n equals 2, you can still solve it. For n equals 3 or more, you just use Mathematica. And what it looks like is the following. So it basically looks like Marchenko-Pastour for a single matrix. Now you see that there's a slightly different scaling here. So this endpoint will now not scale with square root of n, but with some much higher power. And well, this is just what comes out when you solve this polynomial equation, and then you invert for the density. So this is just the global density. So this, okay, n equals 1, Marchenko plus 2. Now the question is, what about the local statistics? Because that was our motivation. You have three areas where you can blow up locally. Now, at the edge, we don't know. In the bulk, we don't know. Of course, the conjecture is that you do get an area kernel here, the sine kernel here. Now, at the origin, things are simpler because you can, well, take the limit. And it turns out that you get something that generalizes the Bessel kernel that you would get for standard random matrix theory. And, well, I will not write down the kernel. There's actually work by Arno Koilas and Lun Zhang, who got a complex contour integral representation for the kernel for n equals 2, I believe. And this is universal because it also appears in another random matrix model of Cauchy type by Marco Bertola. So for the singular values, I would say the origin, it's clear we get something new. So, and at the bulk and at the edge, we only conjecture so far that we get the same. But the problem is open, okay? It is. I mean, locally it is square root. You can see that. And you can even calculate the endpoint, but that's about where it ends. Okay? Now, what about complex eigenvalues? Well, for complex eigenvalues, as I said, life is much simpler. Well, that's something I would like to tell in the last few minutes. So for complex eigenvalues, we could answer these questions without having open problems. N equals 2, that is Lun Zhang. Yes. Even for n equal 2, we don't know that we get a sine kernel or an area kernel. That's right. So that's a paper, I think, 2013. They find actually an interesting map from this bi-orthogonal ensembles to multiple orthogonal polynomials that they can then treat, in principle, writing up a Riemann-Hilbert problem. But they only have written down the problem, not the solution. Okay, so eigenvalues. Maybe let me remind you first what happens for the Geneva ensemble, so for a single random matrix. So again, we can define a macroscopic or global density. And for that, we have to rescale. Of course, I didn't say that here, but to get something that has compact support, we need to put an n here, okay? And then we can take the larger limit. That is why we get more n's here, because we multiply several ones, okay? So what do we get is the circular law. Now we can again look microscopically. We can look either what happens at the edge. There you get that microscopically, after appropriate rescaling, this will behave like a complementary error function. Or in the bulk, for Ginibre, we get the limiting kernel is equal to plus. Okay. So this is what are called the Ginibre universality classes, so to speak. And this is really not difficult to get because, well, if you look back, if it's still on the board. No, it's not. So, well, the kernel was just a truncated exponential. Okay. And then you take the limit, and then inside here, basically, the density will get flat because the weight factor in front and the truncated exponential will just give one. And now, if here you have to blow up this region, and then you get this error function. So this is really simple analysis that Ginibre already did in his paper. Now, what about n larger than 2? So what happens here is the mean density becomes divergent. And it diverges like z to the power 2 over n minus 2. This was again known from previous works by Jacek Burda using planar diagrams and also using free probability theory by my colleague in Bielefeld, Friedrich Götze, and Sasha Tichomirov. So they showed this global density, and what we added to that is the local statistics based on these Meyer G functions. Now, what comes out is the following. At the edge, we get Ginibre. In the bulk, we get Ginibre. And at the origin, we get something new. Okay, that is probably quite clear. And so the new universality class looks as follows. So basically, okay, let me write it down at equal arguments. So you just get and the sum then just becomes a hypergeometric function of z. Okay. So we now have n classes labeled by the number of matrices you multiply. And clearly the origin is singled out. This is basically the end of the story. Let me maybe summarize. So what I've shown to you is that taking products of random matrices, you can indeed round down a joint probability distribution for finite matrix size, finite number of products, solve that in terms of either polynomials in the complex plane or orthogonal functions on the real positive line. You can then study the question of universality. Now, for the singular values, because this kernel is complicated, the question is open so far. For the complex eigenvalues, I think the problem is settled. You can make it more fancy by using these other weights where you have a determinant here, then this g function gets more indices. I wanted to spare you this. Now, other than these open questions of universality, you can think of two directions. One direction that we are also currently writing up is with the initial question that Fürstenberg and Kesten had to calculate Lyapunov exponents. And we have done that. And we can also now compute finite n corrections to that. You have to define what the Lyapunov exponent is. So,
which matrix? I mean, the product of the.
Yeah, you take the product matrix, and then you study the absolute value squares of the eigenvalues. You write that as e to the mu. Then you take the nth power of the absolute value. You take the log, and you take n to infinity. So this will give you the limiting mu is the Lyapunov exponent. And there are results on that by Newman, both for finite matrix size and n goes to infinity. He computed the position, so these Lyapunov exponents will then become deterministic. And if you then again take the matrix size to infinity, you get what's called the triangular law that replaces the semicircle law. And of course, we get the same. We have to get the same. Well, it's not clear. I mean, Newman studied real matrices, so we have different matrices here. But we can also compute corrections to that. The other thing you could think of are different quantities, like probabilities that, well, I can use this drawing here, that some areas void of eigenvalues. These are called whole probabilities. You can take asymptotics. And of course, you can also think of maybe more realistic matrices in the product for physics applications. But this is open. Thank you.